lifted me from the miry clay.
First worship song this morning was written by Reuben Morgan, led by our Grapevine worship team friends, and it's called For All You've Done. Welcome. We're glad you joined us this morning. It's great to have you with us. Welcome to those who are members of Four Ways United, and also to those who are visitors from all over the world. We hope you find us to be a community where there's no judgment, but instead acceptance. We want to create a safe place where you feel at home. My name is Brendan Ash. My wife's name is Pietru, and my children are Nina and Ethan. And I've had a few chapters of ministry. Firstly, as a volunteer at the Goodwood Presbyterian Church, where my dad was the minister for 35 years. Secondly, as a staff member at Somerset West United Church, where I served for 9 years. Thirdly, at Rand Park Ridge United Church, where I served for 10 years. And I'm currently at St. Mungo's United Church, where I've served for 3 years. And finally, at Four Ways United Church, where I've served for nearly 4 weeks. It's a privilege to serve you this morning. I believe that God wants to do a new thing at Four Ways United Church. Our logo says that we're actively loving Christ, and there are three components of our logo. All are based on Scripture and reflect the way we strive to honor and obey the Lord Jesus Christ. Firstly, the central heart is drawn from Luke chapter 10, verse 27. And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself." The inward facing arrow is from John chapter 13, verse 34. "The new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another." And finally, the outward-facing arrows from Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 to 20. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the very end of the age." Our format this morning is once again going to be structured around the Lord's Prayer in Matthew. Jesus tells his disciples, "This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, may your holy name be honored. Give us today the food we need. Forgive us the wrongs we have done as we forgive the wrongs that others have done to us. Do not bring us to hard testing, but keep us safe from the evil one." In the Old Testament, there are many names for God, and each name says something about the qualities of God. This morning, we worship El Shaddai, the Lord God Almighty. We worship El Elyon, the Most High God. We worship Adonai, our Lord and Master. We worship Yahweh, our Lord and Jehovah. We worship Jehovah Nissi, the Lord my banner. We worship Jehovah Ra, the Lord my shepherd. We worship Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that heals. We worship Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there. We worship Jehovah Tzidkenu, the Lord our righteousness. We worship Jehovah Mokadishkem, the Lord who sanctifies you. We worship El Olam, the everlasting God. We worship Elohim, the name for God. We worship Kana, jealous. We worship Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. We worship Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is peace. We worship Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts. May your holy name be honored. Our first song this morning is called 10,000 Reasons. It's written by Matt Redman and led for us by Eleanor Van Noort.
Like never.
strength is failing. The end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forever. The heart of my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name.
May your kingdom come, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. This morning we're going to read through some verses that speak about the kingdom of God. In Matthew chapter 6 we read, "But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." In John chapter 8, Jesus says, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." Being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them, "The kingdom of God is not coming with signs to be observed, nor will they say, 'Look, here it is,' or 'There,' for behold, the kingdom of God is in the midst of you." In Mark chapter 8, we read, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." In Romans, we read, "For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace. Enjoy in the Holy Ghost." In Daniel we read, "And in the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. It shall break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever." In Matthew we read, "From that time Jesus began to preach, saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand.'" In Revelations we read this, "Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, 'The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever.' May your kingdom come, Lord. May all be done as it is on earth as it is in heaven." Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in the barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon, in all his splendor, was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear?' For the pagans run after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Give us today, Father God, the food we need. Father, help us to trust in you." The next song is led by my brother Gareth Ash, written by Brenton Brown. It's called "God My Rock."
When my heart is overwhelmed, I will look to you alone.
God my rock, God my rock, God my rock. You will stand when others fall, you are faithful through it all. God my rock, God my rock, God my rock. In the blessing, in the pain, through it all you've made. You are the strength of my heart. I can rely on you. I can rely on you. When I struggle to believe, you have not let go of me. God, my rock, God, my rock, God, my rock. Carry through the darkest storms, you have held me in your arms. God, my rock, God, my rock, God, my rock. In the blessing, in the pain, through it all you've never failed me. You are the strength of my heart. You are the strength of my heart. I can rely on you. I can rely on you. You are the joy of my life. You are my song in the night. There is no one as true. Jesus, I trust in you.
Forgive us the wrongs we have done as we forgive the wrongs that others have done to us. Father, sometimes we are filled with unforgiveness in our lives. Give us the strength to forgive those who have wronged us. Forgive us for our rebellion. Thank you that you're a God of mercy and grace. We don't deserve your love and forgiveness, but you give it to us for free. Amen. Our next song is going to be sung to us by Keith Horwood and was written by Elisha Hoffman. Are you washed in the blood?
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace, the Son? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? You washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing on this soul unclean. You'll be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Do not bring us to hard testing, but keep us safe from the evil one. Father, we pray that you'll be merciful to us. We know that whatever hardships and challenges we face, that you'll be with us. When we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your rod and staff will protect us. You are a faithful God. Amen. Nehemiah is rebuilding the wall, but things are not going to be plain sailing because he faces opposition at every step. Nehemiah's opposition from outside came from three people: Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arab. In Nehemiah chapter 2 verse 10, two of these characters are introduced to the story. It says, when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard about this, they were very much disturbed that someone had come to promote the welfare of the Israelites. Sanballat was the governor of Samaria, formerly the northern kingdom called Israel, until they were carried off into captivity by the Syrians. And they never returned, and the Jews who remained married people from other nations and were now called Samaritans. Tobiah was the governor of the Ammonite lands, and Geshem was an Arab. And together they conspired against Nehemiah and the people who were rebuilding the wall, and they tried to derail the building of the walls of Jerusalem. Nehemiah faced opposition from outside in the following ways. Firstly, in ridicule; second, mockery; third, conspiracy; and fourth, distraction; and fifth, accusation. The first way they opposed the rebuilding of the walls of Jerusalem was through ridicule. In Nehemiah chapter 2, we read, but when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed us. What is this you are doing? They asked. Are you rebelling against the king? But Nehemiah responds. He says, I answered them by saying, the God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding, but as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or historic right to it. Secondly, Sanballat and Tobiah resort to mockery. In chapter 4, we read the following. When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, what are these feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their will? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from these heaps of rubbles, burned as they are? Tobiah the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, but they are building, even a fox climbing on it would break down their walls of stone. But once again, Nehemiah responds, and this time he responds with prayer. He says, hear us, our God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. Thirdly, they resort to conspiracy. And when Sanballat, Tobiah the Arab, Ammonites and the people of Ashdod heard that the repairs to Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead and that the gaps were being closed, they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. But once again, Nehemiah and the people respond. And Nehemiah says, but we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. And in verse 15, we read the following. When our enemies heard that we were aware of their plot and that God had frustrated it, we all returned to the wall, each to his own work. The fourth way that Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem tried to stop the rebuilding of the wall was distraction. In Nehemiah chapter 6, we read, when word came to Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem the Arab, and the rest of our enemies that I had rebuilt the wall, and not a gap was left in it, though up to that time I had not set the doors in the gates, Sanballat and Geshem sent me this message. Come, let us meet together in one of the villages on the plain of Ono. And I just love Nehemiah's reply. But they were scheming to harm me. So I sent messengers to them with this reply. I am carrying on a great project and cannot go down. Why should the work stop while I leave it and go down to you? Four times they sent me the same message. And each time I gave them the same answer. The fifth way that his enemies tried to derail the building of the wall is accusation. We read, when the fifth time Sanballat sent his aid to me with the same message, and in his hand was an unsealed letter in which was written, also in chapter 6, it is reported among the nations, and Geshem says it's true, that you and the Jews are planning to revolt, and therefore you are building the wall. Moreover, according to these reports, you're about to become their king, and they've even appointed prophets to mark this proclamation about you in Jerusalem. There is a king in Judah. Now this report will get back to the king. So come, let us meet together. And again, Nehemiah responds, I sent them this reply. Nothing like what you are saying is happening. You are just making it up out of your head. They were all trying to frighten us, thinking their hands will get too weak for the work and it will be completed. But I strayed. I prayed. Now strengthen my hands. What has God called you to do? God has called me to make disciples. And I may not face the same type of opposition as Nehemiah, but one thing I know, ministry is hard. We read through the Gospels and the book of Acts, we see opposition and hardships. If Jesus faced opposition and the apostles faced opposition, then we should expect opposition too, because we're in a spiritual battle. Nehemiah responds to all this opposition in two ways. The first is that he prayed. Right at the beginning in chapter 1, he prayed as he becomes aware of the huge task and the favor he's going to need from the king. In chapter 1, it says, when I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Then I said, Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the furthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I've chosen as the dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people, whom you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. And again, when he prepares to speak to the king about the burden on his heart, he once again prays in chapter 2. The king said to me, what is it you want? Then I prayed to the God of heaven. When he prays, when he faces opposition, he prays a simple short prayer. In Nehemiah chapter 6, we read, they were all trying to frighten us, thinking their hands will get too weak for the work and it will not be completed. But I prayed, now strengthen my hands. The second thing we see is that Nehemiah was focused. When they try to distract him, he responds, I am carrying out a great project and cannot go down. Why should the work stop? Well, I leave it and go down to you. Four times they sent me the same message, and each time I gave them the same answer. When it comes to rebuilding the walls of Four Ways United, we can apply these principles from the book of Nehemiah. We need to pray, and we need to stay focused. And the same is true for whatever God is calling you to do. You will face difficulties, you will face opposition, but pray and stay focused. Amen. We would like to invite you to partner with us as we feed and care for the hungry, clothe those who are naked, support those who have been sent by God to make disciples of all nations, tribes, and languages. At the moment, there's only one way to give generously, and that is by EFT into the bank account, but we hope to provide more options as time goes on. You will find the bank details on the website, but they're also on the screen for you. Father God, you give us many gifts, and so we give you these gifts as a symbol of our love for you, And Father God, we pray that you'll use them for the furtherance of your kingdom at Four Ways United and beyond. We ask this in your name. Amen. And so go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them, teaching to obey everything I've commanded. And when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore, until Jesus comes again. Amen. We invite you to join us on Monday nights at 7. We will be discussing Sunday's sermon, getting to know each other, praying together. Contact us, fourwaysunited@gmail.com, on my cell phone number, 084-700-777. We would love to meet you, and we would really like to invite you to join us on Monday evenings at 7 o'clock on Zoom. Have a great week.